Hey, we're going to jump right into the message here. This is the last message in this series that we've been doing for a few weeks called The Body. And we've been looking at how there's just this trend in America that people love Jesus, people are spiritual, and people read Christian books, and people listen to Christian tapes and podcasts, but there's this sense that the church, the local church, what we're here doing today, being the church, is somehow an expendable thing, like it's not that important. And so what we've been trying to do is to understand how the early church thought that meeting together with other Christians was vitally, vitally important. But there's just this idea in America that being a part or a member of a church is not important. We read in Acts that they were absolutely devoted to one another. We read over and over in the New Testament that the church is the actual body of Christ, that we are the visible, physical presence of Christ in our community and in our world. And so we did a couple of things to kind of emphasize the body working together. And one of those things was to do the food packing. We packed over 40,000 meals to send to Haiti. And that was the body coming together to accomplish something that we couldn't do just on our own by ourselves, just kind of doing our own Christian thing. And so last week, we looked at sort of the type of body or the type of church we are. And I talked about different things about our churches, and I would encourage you to go listen to that message. You can go to our YouTube channel and watch it. Maybe you're here this morning, and this is your first time, and you're wondering, what kind of church is this? And you can go there, and you can watch that, as well as you can listen closely to what I'm going to be talking about today. Because from the very beginning of our churches, and the official name of our churches is the Independent Christian Churches and Churches of Christ, began in the early 1800s. But from the very start, our churches had sort of two distinguishing things that sort of set us apart as a church body. And one of those was the weekly observance of communion. Virtually no other Christian group, Catholics do it, but virtually no other Protestant groups have an observance of communion, the Lord's Supper, every single Sunday, and yet we do. We just read in Scripture that that's what they did. Jesus tells us, as often as you meet together, do this in remembrance of me, and so we believe that it's very, very important. And I'm going to talk about that in a moment, but the other thing that sort of has distinguished our churches is kind of our view of baptism. Now, there are a lot of churches that do baptize by immersion, and that's awesome. But I want to tell you just a little bit about why we think the way we think about baptism and about communion. And I also want to talk a little bit about what it means to be a member of a church and why that is such a big deal. But baptism and communion are commandments. They're symbols given to us, commanded by the Lord. And so with baptism, we feel that the Scripture would, and again, our churches, we're simply trying to go by what the New Testament says. And if we can follow what the early Christians did, we're going to do that as closely as possible. And so we find in the book of Acts, the early church, and all throughout Scriptures, that people were baptized when they wanted to become a Christ follower. And so, for example, in our church, we believe that baptism is for those who are old enough to believe. Old enough to make that decision that they want to be a Christ follower for themselves. Now, we think that it's appropriate to dedicate babies, and we do that. In fact, we've had a lot of babies born recently. We're going to have a baby dedication Sunday coming up here, hopefully this summer sometime. But we dedicate babies because we feel like that's, in a sense, what happened in the Gospels when Jesus took the little kids and he set them on their lap and he blessed them. And so we do that. But we don't feel that baptism is appropriate for babies. We don't read of any verse or anywhere in the New Testament where it talks about an infant being baptized. The scriptural example is that those of what we call the age of accountability, just that age, and it varies from kid to kid, when they become aware of their sin and they want to learn about Jesus and they want to be forgiven of their sins. And so when that happens, and parents were to teach our children about this as they grow up, we feel that then it's appropriate as their decision to be baptized. Mark 16:16 says, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. Acts 2:38, Peter preaches the first sermon, the first gospel message. And the people say, what should we do in light of what you've just said? And Peter said, you need to repent and be baptized. There needs to be a decision. There needs to be an act of the will. Now, some of you here maybe were baptized as infants, and I'm not saying that's a horrible thing, and you can be thankful and grateful that your parents loved you and were concerned to bring you up in the Lord at the best of their understanding. But the Bible does seem to make it clear that it needs to be your decision on your own. It's not enough for somebody else to make that decision for you. It's got to be your decision. I want to be a follower of Christ. Somebody has said, God has no grandchildren, only children. And that's true in a sense. And so it's got to be a person's decision. And so we practice what we call believer's baptism by immersion. That is what one does when they want to become a Christ follower. And so we also, again, think that baptism is by immersion, by fully immersing a person in the water and bringing them up. And we do this simply because that's what they did in the New Testament. That's what they did in the early church for hundreds and hundreds of years before sprinkling became a thing. But we read of the first baptism in John 3 when it says that John the Baptist was baptizing because there was plenty of water in the Jordan River. People went down into the water to be baptized, and they were brought up out of the water. And every time in the book of Acts somebody became a Christian, they were baptized by immersion. In fact, in Acts chapter 8, we have a really, really cool example of this. A guy by the name of Philip was told by the Holy Spirit to go down to a road that led to Gaza. And he went there and he came across some people riding in a chariot. And these were government officials. And there was in that chariot an Ethiopian official who had been to Jerusalem to worship God because he had become a Jew. But while he was there, he heard this preaching that Jesus Christ had come and that Jesus was the Messiah. And he was really wrestling with that and really didn't quite know what to make of that. But we read in that passage that when he was told about Christ and had a level of understanding, he expressed his faith by being baptized. And it's really, really cool because they were kind of going along, and all of a sudden this guy says, look, there's some water. What should keep me from being baptized? And I love that because today the question too often that I get and many of us get is, well, do I have to be baptized or should I be baptized? But this man was the opposite. He was like, try to stop me. If that's what I'm to do and if that's what God wants me to do, then I'm going to do it. And he did it right then. Didn't wait till they had a special service in 2 months or whatever. They just did it right then. He went down into the water. He was immersed and he came up out of the water. Now, baptism is something that symbolizes the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ. And similarly, it represents our death to sin, our burial with Christ, and the resurrection we have when we come up out of the water and we're cleansed from our sins. And this is what Scripture tells us happens. Somebody says, well, I was sprinkled as a small child. Should I be immersed? Well, again, we're striving to follow simply what the pattern is in the New Testament. And so we do want a person to be immersed to become a member of our church. And I'll talk about that more in a moment. But listen, we don't want you to be baptized to become a member of our church necessarily, or because Chris wants you to be baptized, or because somebody else wants you to be baptized. We want this to be a decision that you make based on your desire to be obedient, to follow the example of Jesus Christ. And so that's how we should think of it. Again, in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, Peter, the apostle Peter, preaches the first sermon. The people were convicted. They asked, well, what should we do? And Peter said without hesitation in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. So again, baptism has a lot of symbolism, but in a way we can't really fully understand. It's more than just a symbol. Now, there are a lot of church groups and denominations that baptize people by immersion, but oftentimes, it's just sort of an afterthought, like a person becomes a Christian. Then if you want to get baptized, that's a good thing to do, but it's really not, it's not crucial. And we just believe it is. We believe it's an integral part of the process of salvation, that a person would humble themselves and become obedient to what Christ did. He set the example for us. and that we just feel like that's what people should do. Paul puts it this way in Romans chapter 6. He says, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were also baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. You do a word study, or you have a concordance, or you do a search on the app on your phone, and you type in different forms of baptize, baptism, baptize, baptize, whatever. You'll see hundreds upon hundreds of hits from the New Testament, because that's what we're told to do. And so this is the point. This is the point when a person is baptized, when you say, I want everybody to know that I am a Christian, that I am a believer in Jesus Christ. Now, does the water in the baptistry save you? Absolutely not. We're saved by grace. But I do think it's a reflection of our faith. It's a reflection of our commitment and our dedication to Christ. And it's never separated from saving faith in the New Testament. And so we're not going to separate it from saving faith here either. It's just a part of what we're supposed to do when we become Christians for many, many reasons. I've preached many, many full sermons on baptism. I'd love to talk more with you about it. I'd love to have you listen to some of those sermons, but it's extremely important. And from the early days of our churches, we have sort of been distinguished as, well, they're the people that they baptize you right away before you change your mind, right? And that's what my mom said to me when she heard I was going to become in the Church of Christ. And I said, well, I don't know, maybe, whatever. But the other thing that has marked our churches from the start is, again, this weekly practice of taking communion. And we have churches all over the spectrum, all over the country. You can go into a church of 25 people in the hills of Tennessee, where I used to live, to the mega churches of 20,000, to the multi-campus churches that have many different sites spread out all over a town. And you will find in every one of those churches of Christ or Christian churches, you will find an observance every week of the Lord's Supper. Jesus said, as often as you meet together, do this in remembrance of me. Paul said that when we remember Christ in this way, we proclaim his death until he comes again. There are a couple things I want to real quickly cover about our view of communion. First of all, we at our churches, we practice what's called open communion. Now, there are some churches, there are some denominations that unless you are a member of that church, unless you are a member of that denomination, you cannot take communion if you were to visit that church. In our church, we feel like it's not ours to exclude people from. And so we have communion that's open to anybody who wants to take it. That is between an individual and their Lord, whether or not they do it. And let me also say this, that and this may be more my opinion, and it might kind of go against what some people believe or have been taught, but I don't think there's any scriptural reason that we ought to get hung up on whether a child takes communion before they're baptized. This idea, this notion of a first communion is a Catholic idea. It's not in Scripture. Jesus said, let the little children come to me. And if your child wants to take communion, I think it's a good time to instruct them about what it means and open the door to talking with them about baptism. Now, again, people might disagree, think I'm wrong, and I get that, but that's just my thought. I have no problem with children taking communion. It's a chance to teach them. But again, the other thing, as I said, is that we practice communion every single Sunday. Every single Sunday. Acts 20, verse 7, we read, on the first day we came together to break bread. That was written of the church at Troas. And the history of the early Christians seems to indicate that the Christians had the Lord's Supper every week. Now, Jesus didn't say you have to do it every single week. And he didn't say you can only do it on Sundays, but he did say, you know what, when you get together as a church body, you need to do this. You need to remember me. The early church did it weekly. It's not a commandment, so we don't look at others who don't have it weekly as horrible or heretics or anything like that. But we just believe as a church body that we want to surely remember this thing that is the reason why we're here today, because Jesus Christ died for our sins and he was resurrected. And if the early believers, if the first church did it as often as they met together, then I just think that we ought to do that also. And so communion will always be an integral part of our worship services. It won't be relegated to a back room or an afterthought as it is sometimes in other churches, but it's going to be offered at every one of our services on the weekend. Now, there is a danger in this. There's a danger in taking it every week. And many people love to point out the dangers. They say, oh, well, you don't think about what you're doing. It's just a routine. It's just a habit. And I agree that taking communion every week can become just an empty ritual. I think that's the danger with anything. And matter of fact, the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11, he went into that in great detail. They were not careful. They were not observing the Lord's Supper in the right way because they were not thinking of their brothers and sisters in Christ. And so it can become just an empty ritual. And that's why I believe that it's good to change the way communion is taken every once in a while so that it doesn't just become a stale religious ritual that we do without thinking about it, but it stays to be something that's meaningful to us and that we think about. You know, we can take our Christian faith for granted, but communion is a weekly reminder that our salvation and our relationship with God does not come cheap, that it was bought with a price. The advantage of taking communion every week is, again, that we have this weekly reminder of our faith. We have a weekly reminder of why it is that we're here in the first place. There's a well-known painting of the Vietnam War Memorial, which shows a young widow and her daughter, and they're there presumably tracing the name of their loved one. And so it shows the mother and the daughter reaching up on that black marble wall, and they have their hands up, and they're touching it. But the reflection of that memorial isn't their reflection, but it's the reflection of presumably their loved one who had died in the war. And so it's just a very touching picture that as they're reaching up to touch his name, it shows on the other side he's reaching down to touch them as well. I just think that's a great example of what happens when we reach out to take communion. There's the sense that we're touching Christ. And that's why Jesus gave us this memorial and told us to do this in remembrance of him. When we do, I believe that in a very real way, he reaches out to us. He touches us with his love and his grace and his mercy, even as we use that as a way to reach out to him. The other thing is that communion is the participation in the body of Christ. It is a participation in the body of Christ. Now listen, Paul was so upset with the church in Corinth. They were observing the Lord's Supper, but they weren't doing it together as a community. They kind of had their own individual little ways of doing it, and some got there sooner and ate more because they were wealthier than the poorer people who had to work during the day, came in later. There was not community as they were taking it together. And so he wrote something. He said, you need to discern the body. You need to discern the body of Christ, the church, you and I, when you take communion. And so communion is absolutely communicating and communing with God, but it's also celebrating as a church family what he has done with us. And so there's a real sense of renewal that takes place as we remember the cross, as we remember what Jesus did for us. It's a witness to the world. It says, we'll proclaim his coming again until he comes. And so it's a wonder. People wonder, why do you do that? Why do you do this strange thing with the little juice and with the cups? And there are all kinds of jokes about communion. And my favorite thing that ever happened here during communion many, many years ago, there was a guy and he was serving communion. And Lori and I were kind of new to the church at the time, but he was passing communion to us. And she was first. And so she had the plate. Okay, the plate with the communion, and she was trying to get the cup out, but it was stuck. And she was wrestling with this cup of juice, trying not to spill it, you know, whatever. And this guy leaned down to her, and he says, Lori, he said, you have to really want it. And I thought that was so funny. I just love that because that's true in a sense, that this is something that we should really want to do. And when we have to miss church on a Sunday for whatever reason, there ought to be sort of an emptiness within us that we haven't taken communion on that particular day. And so this is something that is so, so important. Again, 1 Corinthians, Paul says, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. When I was a kid in the early 70s, we had a family that lived in our neighborhood, and they kept their Christmas lights burning not only during Christmas, but all through January, they left those lights on. And it was okay for a while, but by the end of January, we were wondering, what's going on? Are they ever going to take those lights down? But February and March came, and the lights were still up. At the end of May, they had a sign up that said, "Welcome home, Danny." Their son had been overseas in the military, and they were keeping the Christmas lights burning, waiting for their son to come home for Christmas. And you know, in a very real sense, communion is the Christian standing vigil, saying, we believe he's coming back. We're not going to give up. We're not going to give up waiting because we believe that he is coming back. And so we know that he died for us. And so we're lifting up our heads because our redemption is drawing near. And so Paul would say, Jesus says, as often as you do this, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. I mentioned before in Acts chapter 2 that Peter told the people that they needed to repent and to be baptized. And it says that around 3,000 of them were added to their number that day. The church was about 125 before that, and then all of a sudden there are thousands of people, and it says that they were added to their number. But here's the question that I have when I read that in Acts chapter 2. It says that they were added to their number, but their number of what? They were added to what? Were they added to some philosophical system, some loose-knit gathering? No, they were added to the church. And Acts chapter 2 goes on to say that they were devoted to one another, that the church had some sort of structure around it, that there was a leadership structure, that there were expectations, that they covenanted with one another to do life together and to be the church as Christ had envisioned it. Talks about them selling their possessions and eating together and all kinds of things that they did in community. And for this reason, Paul writes in Ephesians 2, "So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God." I love that phrase, the household of God, the local expression of that universal church, that the local the expression of the body of Christ. And so when we talk about being a member of the church, we're not talking about a salvation issue, although I do think that it reflects on our faith and our salvation. It's a reflection of it. But we're talking about doing what they did back in that day and just saying, I want to be a part of this body of Christ. I know that I need people around me to help me, to lift me up, to make me better, to sharpen me, and I want to be a member of the church of Jesus Christ. If somebody says, well, it's all about my rights and what I should get as a member of this church. Well, we're talking about kind of an upside-down thing where we don't become a member to get rights. We become a member to give up our rights. And so instead of coming to the church on Sunday and thinking, man, I hope that it's good today, we're coming thinking, God, who do you want me to minister today? God, is there somebody who is hurting that you can help me reach out to? Is there somebody that I need to be praying for? Is there somebody that I need to encourage? God, is there some need that I can jump into and fulfill it? What do I need to do? You see, membership doesn't come with rights. We exchange those rights for responsibility. We become servants. We come in and say, how can I serve? How can I help to glorify and make famous the name of Jesus in this place? It's not membership of a country club. It's a membership in a body, a family, a household of God. In our church, to be a member of our church, we simply would say that you need to be immersed, baptized, like I had just talked about. Maybe you've already done that. Maybe you've already been immersed. Then you would just come forward in just a moment and say, hey, I've already been baptized. I want to become a member of this church. I want to be added to this church. And that would be awesome. In Colossians chapter 2, we find these incredible words. It says, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. Christ is before all things, and in him all things hold together." In Jesus, all things hold together. Several years ago, there was this video that was making the rounds by a popular preacher named Louis Giglio. And Louis Giglio was talking about this amazing molecule, this protein molecule in our body called laminin. And it's a cell adhesion molecule. in our bodies, the cells organize themselves into certain molecular structures, and it determines what protein they are. And so what function they have within our body. And so laminin is a cell adhesion molecule. The best way to think of it is as glue that holds our bodies together. It's the molecule for being responsible for holding our bodies together, kind of like rebar in concrete. It keeps everything from flying apart. And you saw that was a scientific diagram of what it looks like. And here's what it looks like in your body. And it's the shape of a cross. Now, we can get carried away with this illustration, but it's interesting to me that when God would want to make something that would hold our body together, he would fashion it in the shape of a cross, because that's really what holds our body together. That's what holds our church together, is the cross of Jesus Christ. Colossians says, in him all things hold together. And God knows you intimately, and he chose this symbol to hold you together, the cross. And I don't know, maybe in your life you feel as though you might be falling apart, coming apart at the seams. Maybe it's a job situation or a relationship situation, or maybe it's your marriage or whatever it might be. You need to know that all things hold together in God. So friends, listen to me. It's the same with our church body. The only thing that can ultimately hold us together is to understand that we are Jesus's body, and in him we hold together. So I just want to encourage you and plead with you to love one another, to encourage each other, to pray for each other, to assume the best about each other before the worst. And let us together raise the name of Christ, in whom all things are.